So I'm going to talk about some work that appeared in that paper like a year ago, and also some work in progress with a number of people. So let me just make like motivate like I mean the analysis that I'm going to discuss by just like remind you that like. So when we mean, when we're talking about supersymmetric vacua in supersymmetric field theories, so essentially like we can define the supersymmetric vacua by this property, so that the supersymmetry, like rigid supersymmetry variation of some fermionic operator, let's say, which is given by this anticommutator here, is equal to zero. So this holds like in the quantum theory. However, the usual argument, like for supersymmetric localization, relies on a classical version of that statement, which is the following. So if you just compute like the classical, so here imagine that we have like some microscopic Lagrangian, like with depending on like microscopic fields X over which we path integrate, then we can like the expectation value of this variation here is takes this form, and then now the argument is that. You can, well, classical invariance under supersymmetry means that you can pull this inside here, so we can always write like this, so that's fine. However, now there is a non-trivial assumption in the next step, which is like putting this equal to zero, because here we are assuming that like we can pull this we can pull like the path integral measure, if you want, like inside. So this means that like, I mean, we are assuming that supersymmetry has no anomaly. So is preserved by the path integral measure, which might not always be the case. So another way to say this is that essentially we are assuming that the cohomology, the Q cohomology, like at the classical Q cohomology, is not is the same as the quantum Q cohomology. So in this talk, I will provide some evidence that this might not always be the case, and the two, the classical and the quantum Q cohomology, might not necessarily be the same. So, and this is not something that is entirely surprising because there are already well-known examples of that. So, and here is like n equal one super Virasoro algebra in two dimensions. And indeed, there is such an anomaly here. So like here, this is like the usual conformal anomaly in the Virasoro algebra. And in this commutator here, which is the same as the like Q square like expression that I wrote earlier. So here you see that, I mean, you get this expression, which is also the classical part of the algebra. But you also get at the quantum level, you get this anomalous contribution here. So the statement is that like at four dimensions to six dimensions, there are anomalous terms of this type. However, the difference is that in two dimensions, this anomalous term survives in flat space, but in higher dimensions, it only appears in curved space. So let me just summarize the result, and then I will go through the explanation. So if you just recall like the supersymmetry algebra like in flat four-dimensional space, it can be written in this form, like a little bit schematically maybe. So this is like the stress tensor here. So S is the supercurrent. This T is the stress tensor, and J is like is a U1 current, like so the R-symmetry current if it exists in the theory. And now what we're going to do is like generalize this to a curved background that admits rigid supersymmetry. So in that case, like several of these expressions here, they become like covariantized, and this zeta plus here and zeta minus are the two components of the Killing spinor. So the Killing spinor satisfies this equation generically on curved manifolds. In flat space, you get zero here, so zeta minus equal to zero, so you don't get this term. But in curved space, generically, you only have like this kind of conformal Killing spinors. So you get this other contribution as well. But the important part is that you also get this local term here, what I call this A zeta, which depends like just on locally on the background field. So in particular, in this case, it depends like on the background metric and the background for the R symmetry current. So I will provide like some like derivation of this anomaly and in some specific context and then discuss some of the consequences. So the plan of the talk is, first of all, I'm going to discuss a little bit like the superconformal world densities and the related Toft anomalies. And then like remind you like of the recent progress in developing rigid supersymmetric backgrounds in on especially like on four dimensions, in four dimensions, and then I will revisit a problem that has been studied in the context of supersymmetry on rigid supersymmetry on curved backgrounds, which is like the dependence of the partition function on certain geometric data of these supersymmetric backgrounds. And then I will discuss like the rigid supersymmetry anomaly and the implication like in this context. And finally, I will mention some quick comments about the Casimir charges and the BPS relation and how they're affected by this anomaly. Okay, so if there are no questions, let me start with the superconformal world densities. So as we saw like in a couple of slides ago, so generically for n equal one supersymmetry on in four dimensions, which is what I'm going to focus on, we have this the supercurrent multiplet contains like the stress tensor, the supercurrent, and if we have like if it's a superconformal theory, generically it also contains like the U1R current, plus also some auxiliary fields. So generically you can package all these currents in a superfield. So here, so generically they appear in this form in terms of this vector superfield. But also these dots here indicate that depending on, there are different ways of coupling it, of packaging this like into a super multiplet, and how you pack it depends like on a number of auxiliary fields. So besides the auxiliary fields, there is also some ambiguity that is called the improvement terms. So for example, you can always shift the currents like the stress tensor and the supercurrent in, by terms of this form without changing their defining properties. Right, so now there are different multiplets that have been studied over the years. So the most recent and most general one is the so-called S-multiplet that was found by Komargowski and Seiberg in 2010. And this multiplet always exists. And it contains two auxiliary fields. So it's like a chiral superfield X and also an auxiliary spinor superfield chi alpha. And the defining relations of these of these multiplets, so the is that they satisfy these expressions here. Then there are special cases of this S multiplet that were historically found like before. So the most well known is the so-called Ferrara-Zumino multiplet, which is obtained by setting the chi alpha auxiliary field to zero. And there is also the R multiplet, which is relevant for superconformal theories that have like a U1R symmetry. And that corresponds to setting the X auxiliary field to zero. So the way I would like to view these defining relations in the rest of the talk is as some kind of word identity. So in other words, they're kind of classical conservation equations. So if you expand this, if you expand the superfields here in components, what you will find is conservation equations for all the component currents. So I'm saying classical because at this moment, like we haven't turned on a background field, so we cannot like see the anomalies, like the potential Toft anomalies that can appear in these conservation equations. Right. So now, in order to see these potential anomalies, like we want to couple this theory to like at least in the beginning, like linearized supergravity. So here I'm going to be a little bit schematic. So most of these expressions that I'm going to write down, they are applied like to strictly speaking to the S multiplet, but the argument is not like does not depend on the details of what I'm showing here. So like to couple the theory linearly to supergravity, we just add the coupling of this form where this S is again this current superfield. And then this background HI contains like linearized supergravity fields. And then we are, in order to like derive or encode, if you want, like these defining relations of this multiplet, we assign like local gauge transformations on these background fields. So here we so this H transforms like in this way. And now if you expand this transformation in components, then you will find all the usual local symmetry. So you will find like diffeomorphisms, local frame rotations, while transformations and also U1 and both local supersymmetry transformations, the Q and S supersymmetry transformations. So precisely which transformations of this appear depend again like on the multiplet and how you gauge fix this S multiplet, but this is not relevant for what we want to do here. So, right, so then once you assign these gauge transformations to these background fields, you can actually derive back the original defining relations through an ether argument if you want. So namely, you just demand that this coupling here is invariant under this transformation. So you integrate by parts, and then you get these conservation equations. So these conservation equations here. Right. So now we have the transformation under these local symmetries of the background fields, like this H here. And now, first of all, we have to see how we define this supercurrent. Current superfield, which we can obtain by if the generating function is given by this expression, so we can define it to be the functional derivative with respect to the background fields. So this is, if you want, like the standard definition of the operators in the so-called locally normalization group of Osborne. So here I just wrote this like for this current superfield. Now I should just mention this as a side comment. This definition here is the so-called, gives you the so-called consistent current, which is not the same as the so-called covariant current, and the two differ by in the Zumino terms. So in particular, the covariant current cannot be written as a gradient of the generating functional in this form. So now what I want to do is like I want to consider the transformation of the of this operator, of this current superfield, under these local gauge symmetries. And this is, in principle, straightforward to do. You can just like take the definition here plus the transformation of the background field here, and then you just apply the chain rule here. So you get the transformation of this derivative using the transformation of the source. Plus here, potentially, you get this term here, which is non-zero provided there are Toft anomalies. So if this generating functional is not invariant under this gauge transformation, so in other words, if there are Toft anomalies, then you will get an anomalous contribution here. So the main point, like I mean, that I want to make is precisely this fact that actually you get this anomalous transformation for the operators, for the current operators. Okay, so now. So in principle, you can just compute this expression directly by brute force, but there is also like an elegant way of doing it, which is using an underlying symplectic structure that exists like on the space of couplings, on the background fields and local operators. And you can define on this symplectic space, you can define a Poisson bracket that takes this form. So here again, it's like this background fields and the dual operators. So you can always define this symplectic, this Poisson bracket. And then once you have this Poisson bracket, then you can see that like this local expression here, so this is just the defining property or this word identity that I mentioned for the superfields, now generates local gauge symmetries. So in other words, this becomes like a first class constraint on this space of couplings and local operators. And if you take the Poisson bracket with the generalized coordinates, so this is like the background fields, then you obtain this, and then you obtain back the original transformation that we had like for the fields. However, the interesting part is to obtain the transformation of the supercurrent superfield, which is again given by the Poisson bracket of the superfield with the same constraint here. So, and again, I mean, you get this expression. So notice now if there is an anomaly contribution here, so because you're, so the anomaly would depend on the background fields, so that is H, and then you get a contribution from this derivative here. So this is a generic expression that you can always apply to find the transformation of the operators or the supercurrent superfield in this particular case. Okay, so now, so this was like the transformation under the local symmetries, like on arbitrary curved backgrounds. But now we are interested in defining like global symmetries or like Killing symmetries or rigid symmetries if you want. And that simply corresponds to defining, like looking for solutions of the equation that the variation under these local symmetries of the background fields is equal to zero. So this is just like the local gauge transformation of the background field, but now we are setting this to zero, and then we get like the generalized Killing spinor equation or Killing vector equation for these parameters L0. So this can be solved, and then we can find the precise like parameters L0 that correspond to the Killing symmetries. And using the word entities, then we can define the corresponding conserved charges. And then the transformation of the operators under these conserved charges now. So this is like the rigid symmetries. The transformation of the operators under the rigid symmetries is again given by this commutator or anti-commutator, depending on the spin of the component. So strictly speaking, this is a Dirac bracket now. It's not a Poisson bracket anymore, but that's a technical complication. But you can use this expression here to compute the rigid variation of the operators under the global rigid symmetry. So, and this particularly includes like these supersymmetry variations of the supercurrent. So if you do this game in flat space, like in four-dimensional flat space, here I write again for the S multiplet, you will get precisely these familiar looking expressions. So for the S multiplet, you have like these two auxiliary fields, but then otherwise it looks precisely as I wrote at the beginning of the talk. So it's just, this is what you get like by just looking at 3D supersymmetry in flat space. Okay, so now we want to go one step further and couple the theory to non-linearly to background supergravity. And one way to do that is the so-called Festuccia-Seiberg argument, where you generically couple the theory to some off-cell supergravity and then freeze the gravitational degrees of freedom, so it becomes background. And then the corresponding superconformal Toft anomalies can be determined for arbitrary anomaly coefficients. So in four dimensions, we have the A and C anomaly coefficients. So for arbitrary values of those, the anomalies can be determined by Wezumino consistency condition argument. And this has been done a long time ago for the Ferrara-Zumino multiplet. So there is a covariant curve phase, and curved superspace formulation of the supergravity, and then you can compute, like using Wezumino consistent conditions, you can compute all the possible contributions to the superconformal anomalies. But still, it's kind of tricky to extract the fermionic components of this anomaly that are relevant for the calculation that I'm interested in here. Right, so, however, there is an alternative way of computing these anomalies, which relies on holography. So in particular, if you start from minimal gauge supergravity in five dimensions, then this describes holographically n equal one off-cell conformal supergravity on the four-dimensional boundary. The disadvantage is that in that case, you only get a equal to c anomaly coefficient, so you cannot see the general form of the anomaly, but nevertheless, I mean, this is already general enough to recover this rigid anomaly that that we're going to see later on. So in that context, you have like a bunch of bulk fields. So in particular, you have like the bulk field bind, the gravitino and the U1 gauge field, and asymptotically, they have arbitrary sources. So these arbitrary sources become the off-cell n equal one supergravity, conformal supergravity background. And then you can define the dual operator, so the multiplet, that the supercurrent multiplet, in the way that we saw earlier. So you just take the variation of the generating functional and you define the operators in through this variation here. Okay, so now, this part is the technical part of this paper that I mentioned. So you have to do a holographic normalization for this bulk supergravity theory, like, and be careful like to preserve supersymmetry at all stages. But after you do that, then you can derive like the superconformal world identities for this particular supergravity multiplet. And the result, so I'm not writing here the bosonic ones. You also get the bosonic ones. But here I'm just writing the fermionic ones, which is like here the derivative of the supercurrent and the gamma trace of the supercurrent. And the important thing is that this is like how the ADS-CFT dictionary works. So when you compute the classically something in the bulk, so that corresponds to the large n limit in the dual field theory, but it's still a quantum calculation. So in particular, you still get the like the quantum anomalies, like the total anomalies in the corresponding world entities. So we get this, these two anomalies here, and the explicit form of this is this. So notice that they are proportional to C, so the central charge, and again, A equal to C in this case, so you cannot distinguish between which part is corresponds to A and which part corresponds to C. So they are pretty complicated. One point that is kind of interesting to notice is that like these terms here that I wrote in orange, you can actually pull them like to the left-hand side of this word dentis and combine them with this R current here. And what it corresponds to is like shifting the R current from the covariant expression, which is this J that enters here, from the consistent, which is this J here, to the covariant one that corresponds to this combination here. Okay, but then there are also like these other terms here that depend like on the curvatures of the background metric and also of the background U1R current. Sure. Ah, here. Right. Well, so I will show you, like, I mean, the n equal one backgrounds that like support like rigid supersymmetry, and like for generic backgrounds of that form, they are actually non-zero. These expressions here, but this is what you get, like, I mean, from the calculation. So I don't know if I answered like the. That's right. Yeah. I mean, so you can see. I mean, they have some nice properties. These terms have nice properties under like valid transformations and under like, I mean, super valid transformations. So they solve. You can check that they solve the Wessumino consistency conditions, for example. Right. So then, I mean, we can we can compute the supersymmetry transformations on the boundary. So that is like the off-cell n equal one conformal supergravity transformations for the background fields. And we can do this in a number of ways. So one way is just like to expand the bulk fields and the bulk supersymmetry transformations and then deduce the transformations of these boundary sources. Another way is to use this Poisson structure like that that I mentioned earlier. And this is actually much more powerful because it helps us like to evaluate the transformation of the supercurrent, which is the one that we're interested in. So using this Poisson bracket that I defined earlier, you can compute now the transformation, the supersymmetry transformation of the supercurrent, and you find these expressions. So this is like the epsilon plus here. So there are two local supersymmetries. So the epsilon plus is the usual Q supersymmetry, and the epsilon minus is the so-called S supersymmetry, or like supervalued transformations. And then under those transformations, the again, local transformations, the supercurrent transforms in this particular way. So you see now all these colored terms, they are local. They are they just depend on local curvatures of the background. So they represent the Toft anomaly. So and they precisely come from the Toft anomalies in the world entity. So essentially, these terms here, the orange and the red, they are the derivatives of these terms and these terms here. So it's just like the derivative of those terms with respect to the source of the supercurrent, which is like this gravitino background, right? I mean, so this is linear in this psi, and also all these terms are linear in psi. So essentially, if you take the derivative with respect to this psi, you get precisely these terms here that I wrote. So this is the essential part, like, I mean, of the calculation. So it tells us that under local supersymmetry transformations, this supercurrent transforms in an anomalous fashion. Okay, so now let me review a little bit like of rigid supersymmetry on curved backgrounds. So there are different versions of like rigid supersymmetry. So the most straightforward and like although very restrictive definition is like looking like for a covariantly constant spinor. Then there are like there are conformal generalizations of that to the so-called twister equation, which is similar to what I had. And then there are like also twist like by line bundle, so you get like this this equation here. And then there are also the transformations that you get, like I mean, for from the coupling to some background supergravity. So if you couple to conformal supergravity, you get this Killing spinor equation, which is the what you get from the setting the variation of the gravitino here. So setting this variation to zero, you get precisely this transformation here. And then there is another supergravity which applies also to non-conformal theories, the so-called new minimal supergravity, and the Killing spinor equation in that case that comes from the gravitino variation is given here. So now these Killing spinor equations have been studied like extensively, and the backgrounds that admit rigid symmetries or Killing spinors, they have been classified. And Killing spinors of a new minimal and conformal supergravity, they have been discussed firstly in these two papers here. And so for n equal one theories in four dimensions, like they can be coupled like to different supergravities using again the Festuccia-Seiberg argument. And then you get like different Killing spinors like on the corresponding backgrounds. However, there are some differences like between the backgrounds generically, but between conformal, so between Killing spinors of conformal supergravity and new minimal supergravity, the difference is only like in global properties of the background, which are not relevant for what I want to talk about. So I will not worry about this. So I'm going to work like mostly with backgrounds of conformal supergravity, but they apply also to new minimal supergravity. So finally, an important point to keep in mind is that now this description of rigid supersymmetry is actually independent of the particular theory. So it only depends on the manifold and the Killing spinor equations that you put on it. Okay, so so manifolds that admit two Killing spinors, Z and Z tilde, so like this is like in Euclidean signature, of opposite R charts are generically T2 vibrations over a Riemann surface, and the metric can be parameterized in terms of these functions here. Sorry, apologies for this C here. It's not the same as the central charge. It's just like a conventional notation. So such manifolds, they possess like a complex Killing vector, which can be built like is a sandwich of these two Killing spinors, which commutes like with its conjugate. And in Lorentzian signature, these two spinors become a complex conjugate. So however, I'm going to focus like for like the applications of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to focus on a special case of these backgrounds, which are in which case one of the two circles is trivially fibered. So in that case, you can write the manifold, the four-dimensional manifold, like this over the three-dimensional base, which has metric, which has this metric. So this is now you can dimensionally reduce here on the trivial cycle, and then you get in three dimensions you get cipher manifolds, which I think like Cyril is going to talk about on Friday, and also if the second cycle is also trivially fibered, then you get the A twist like in two dimensions. So and then there are like some specific examples here of manifolds that are of this type. Okay, so now let me review this analysis like on partition functions on curved backgrounds admitting two Killing spinors of opposite charts. So this was work done by Closet, Dumitrescu, Festucci, and Komargovsky in two papers from 2013 and 2014. So in the first paper, they studied the linearized deformation problem around flat space. And in the second one, they generalize that like non-linearly using the holomorphic twist. So now for four-dimensional manifolds that admit two Killing spinors of opposite charge, then the conclusion was that the partition function does not depend on the Hermitian metric on M4, and also depends like holomorphically on a subset of the complex structure and light bundle moduli. But in the case where one of the cycles is trivially fibered, which is the one that I'm going to focus on, then you can boil down these conditions on the property that the partition function is independent of these three complex functions that parameterize the three-dimensional base, this red one here. Okay, so, and then let me just like outline the proof they gave like in the first paper, which was like around flat space. So if you have now the R multiplet in n equal one theories, so it has like also this U1R, and it has like this spectrum here. So, and the dual background fields are given here. So, and then you can show that like in the flat space supersymmetry algebra takes this form. So this is like this supercurrent, and then this team you knew here is this combination of all the bosonic operators, and it is conserved. So, so this again like is in flat space, but you have like this conservation equation, and then J here that appears here is this complex structure of the manifold M, and it can be written in terms of spinor bilinear. Right, so now the argument is that if you take the variation of the generating function, of the partition function with respect to these parameters like the background fields, then you can always write the variation. Here I'm just writing the variation of the Lagrangian, but you should think of it as integrated over. So you can always write by the definition of these operators in this form. So here I'm missing some deltas on the right-hand side, sorry. So, right, so now given now the form of this background metric that like preserves, like admits like rigid supersymmetry, then you can express it. So this background metric was like this metric here again. So you can express this metric in this form. So this is a little bit of algebra, but it's straightforward, and then you find that you can express this variation here, this generic variation in this form. So basically the variation is proportional to these particular components of this bosonic operator. But then the point is that this bosonic operator was Q exact, so it can be written as the Q variation of this supercurrent. So again, revisiting the argument that we had at the beginning, so this means that the partition function is invariant under these deformations. So again, there is a caveat in this argument, namely that the algebra that we're using here, namely this algebra, is actually the classical algebra. So, well, strictly speaking, this is flat space, so even the quantum algebra would not change, but if we apply the same argument like to nonlinear deformations, then the anomaly here could potentially appear. So, okay, so that is the statement, like, I mean, from this analysis. So now let us look at, there was a follow-up paper by this gentleman here in late 2016, where they decide like to holographically check this statement by computing the partition function holographically on spaces that admit like these boundary conditions that are like these backgrounds that admit global supersymmetry. So in particular, the metric again here, so these are like asymptotically ADS5, locally ADS5 backgrounds with boundary data given by these expressions here. So I just reparameterized these functions A and C slightly. So here we have like this this mu and then this this function W, and this W and mu, sorry, and also this this constants gamma prime and gamma, and then some total Gates transformation lambda. So this, locally, this is like a pure Gates, so it plays an important role like for the global analysis, but for the local analysis that I'm doing, it doesn't play any role. So then these are analytic continuations of the T2 vibrations like in Euclidean signatures. So these are like Lorentzian backgrounds. So, and then the Killing spinor equations are the ones that I wrote earlier. So it's just like the conformal supergravity Killing spinor equations, but with Z minus non-zero in generically in these backgrounds. So now you, what you can do is like you can evaluate the renormalized on selection and then see if it depends on these generic functions mu and w. And what they find is that, so the w variation gives this expression here, and the mu variation gives this expression. So in particular, it seems that they are not invariant. So this, seems to be a contradiction to the previous claim, like in field theory, that the partition function should be independent of these functions. So, but okay, so now let us see like the, how we can match like this, resolve this tension. So let us go back to the, quickly to the transformation here of like that we computed earlier. So this is like the transformation again of the supercurrent under local supersymmetry transformations like Q and S supersymmetry transformations. But now I want to focus on solutions of the Killing spinor equation, of the conformal Killing spinor equations. So in that case, these epsilon zeros become like the different components of the Killing spinor Z. So now they are related. And if I use this expression, I get the following expression for the variation of the supercurrent. So here we get, right, so now the Killing spinor has like these two non-trivial components. So there is these terms here which depend again on the R current and also the stress tensor. But the important thing is that like there are these color terms here, the orange and the red, which are local terms depending on the background. So what is important here is that like these particular backgrounds I did mention is that actually all the bosonic anomalies, they are numerically zero. So although the central charge is non-zero, so that there are generically Toft anomalies in the world identities, when you evaluate numerically, for example, the Weyl anomaly or the U1R anomaly, they are numerically zero on these particular backgrounds that admit these Killing spinors. However, if you evaluate these bosonic expressions here, which enter in the rigid variation of the supercurrent, they are actually non-zero generically. Only in very, like only if you specialize to particular backgrounds, then you can actually set them to zero. But for a generic class of backgrounds that admits like two Killing spinors of opposite R charge, they are not zero. So now let's use this result and repeat the analysis, well, repeat the argument of collaborators. So what we can do is like we can take again the variation with respect to W and mu. And again, if you remember, we can relate it to, so this part here. So the fact that you can relate it, you can write in this form, so in terms of this bosonic operator here, so this still applies. So again, you can write in terms of all the bosonic currents. However, what doesn't apply now is this expression here, that this bosonic current is the Q of the supercurrent. So the difference is that now we have that this bosonic current is the Q variation of the supercurrent plus the anomalous terms here. So now, then if I put these anomalous terms on the other hand side, then by the same supersymmetry argument, this term would give me zero, but I will get the extra terms like from the anomaly. Right, so in particular, I will get like the extra terms from these expressions. And if I evaluate them on the particular background, so I get these components here of the anomalous transformation of the supercurrent. And then if I evaluate them on the background, I get precisely this expression. And the same from the mu transformation, so I get some different components here of the transformation of the supercurrent. And then if you evaluate them, you get exactly these terms. So now if you compare these final expressions with the result found by genolinear collaborators, so they match precisely. So however, the transformation, the calculation is slightly different because so here the calculation was done by evaluating explicitly the on-cell action and then varying with respect to the bosonic transformations. So there were no fermions in this calculation. However, if you keep the fermions in the analysis, thanks, then you can actually repeat the argument of Closet and collaborators, and then you find precisely that these terms here, the non-invariance of the generating functional, is indeed precisely because of the anomalous transformation of the supercurrent. So again, the argument that we give is completely analogous to the one by Closet and collaborators. And then, however, we do the variation around an arbitrary background, so it's not around flat space, so it's closer like to the analysis like in the second paper that they have. And, right, so this seems to suggest that actually the generating functional does depend on these functions. And then, so I apply this this argument to these particular backgrounds that admit, like, I mean, this much supersymmetry, but the local transformation of the supercurrent that I computed is more general, so you can apply it to any background, like, even if it admits, like, one supercharge or, like, even more than two. So very quickly, let me just point out like some consequences of this anomaly. So namely now from the word identity and the Killing spinor equations, you can, for the Killing spinors, you can construct the corresponding conserved charges. So here is the electric charge and here is the conserved charge associated with this Killing vector K, which is the bilinear, the spinor bilinear. So now there is this arbitrary parameter omega here, which allows you to define, in this case, different type of charges. So for omega equal to minus 2, you get the so-called Maxwell charges. And for omega equal to 1, you get the Pace charges. So now, if you use the fact that in a supersymmetric vacuum, the variation of the supercurrent is equal to 0, and you contract this identity with this spinor, then you, you can relate the spinor bilinears that enter here to the Killing vectors. And then you obtain this BPS condition for every value of omega. So this holds like for any values, for any choice of omega. But then on the right-hand side, you have an anomalous contribution, which depends precisely on this anomalous transformation of the supercurrent. So it's a lengthy expression that is in the paper, but it's precisely the integral, if you want, of this anomalous transformation of the supercurrent. So here, this is just the mass and the angular momentum. Okay, so let me conclude. So it seems that like in generic curved backgrounds that admit like some notion of rigid supersymmetry, this rigid supersymmetry is anomalous at the quantum level. And in particular, this implies that the supersymmetric partition function might not be independent of the background data. So in particular, this Hermitian metric and the complex structure. And also this anomaly affects like the BPS equation between like the conserved charges, like the Casimir energy and the other Casimir charges. So there are a number of future directions that would be interesting to explore. So one of them is like to determine the supercurrent anomaly for arbitrary coefficients A and C. So for this and for different versions of supergravity directly from the field theory point of view. So I know there's like a number of people who are looking into that already. Then it would also be interesting to see if there are concrete examples where localization computations are affected by this anomaly. And then finally, there is some discussion about whether you can actually like transform this supersymmetry anomaly into an anomaly of a different type, such as a gravitational anomaly. So this was already hinted in the paper of David and collaborators. So in that case, they give a counterterm, a local counterterm, that is actually not completely diffeomorphism invariant, So this would suggest that actually if you add this counter term, you remove the anomaly from the supersymmetry, but then you have some kind of gravitational anomaly. So, and I also, I think also there are like people looking into this as well. Thank you.